I'd like to share with you the coming of Jesus. How many of you are really, really ready for the coming of Jesus? No one? I think I need to change the topic and, you know, share salvation. How many of you are really, 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 really ready for the coming of Jesus? Okay, praise God. So my text today is Revelation chapter 22, beginning verse 12 up to 20. It's all about the coming of Jesus. So how many of you are watching or, you know, listening to the current events? You know, what's, you know, the things happening today, and so many things happened this week, you know. Let's say the legalization of same-sex marriage, you know. Yeah, a lot of countries now are asking from their government to legalize also. So what must be our reaction, you know? So Christianity is not doomed. Whether they like it, whether they're going to do more for that. And you know what? I don't know if it is a humor or just a joke. But another thing that they want to push through is the legalization of polygamy. And then the legalization of marijuana all over the United States of America. So I don't know, but so whatever happens, we need to be ready. Amen? And let's take this opportunity, a great opportunity to present the gospel of truth, the Lord Jesus Christ. Of course, we all already heard, you know, the killings of 9 believers inside the church, of one racist guy, and he killed after the Bible study. He attended Bible study first, and he killed the pastor, and I think one of the associate pastor, and several members of the church. But instead of fear, the resolve of many people became so wild, and the fire started in their hearts to do more for God. And if you're watching, many relatives of those victims learn how to forgive, even though there's so much anguish and anger in their hearts. But they choose to forgive than to retaliate. I think that's the best example of showing the Lord's grace and mercy. And there are some other things. There are some people trying to hurt us, you know, to tear us down. But it's good. It's good to do great things than to retaliate or to revenge. And of course, another world news, the killing of 39 tourists in Tunisia just a few days ago. Tunisia is part of a North America continent, neighboring Libya, and there's a civil war going on in Libya nowadays. And those, most of them are, most victims are British, Britons, you know. And a lot of people now are panicking, and many tourists are trying to get out of the country as soon as possible. So many things going on, and of course the earthquakes in different parts of the world, and volcanic eruption, and natural resources calamities by having natural disasters, and of course civil war and religious war in the Middle East. And now ISIS is under threat by Al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda, they have different mindset, you know. And ISIS also, they have different mindset. So there's so many things going on in this world. And of course, when it comes to media, one of the best product is to magnify the problem so that, you know, people will be tuned in to whatever they are trying to tell the people. I don't know if there are some media reporting that by the thousands people are coming to Jesus, that every day there are people, you know, giving their lives to Jesus every single day all over the world. Have you heard? A lot of things going on in the body of Christ, you know, and there's a revival going on in different parts of Asia, different parts of South Africa, so on and so forth. So the point is this: God is alive and is doing something great in the whole wide world. And the devil is trying his very best to deceive, to steal, to kill, and to destroy the lives of many. We must stand together, and we need to be strong in the Word of God. This is not the time to play. Will you please tell to your neighbor, this is not the time to play. There are so many Christians, they keep playing in their spiritual life, playing in their walk with God. They are not so serious about walking with the Lord. And I think this is a time for us to be serious. Amen? Praise God. Stop being cool. You need to be on fire for the Lord. Hello, are you with me? Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We ask the Holy Spirit to be our teacher for today. And we pray, God, that you bless us and encourage us and strengthen us and have and give us that kind of perspective, Lord, that will really, Lord God, strengthen our very foundation. Father, we just entrust everything to you. Let your name be exalted as we study the Word of God. This we pray in Jesus' name. Everyone said, amen. Revelation 22, verse 12 to 20. And I would like to start from this verse in Revelation 22, verse 16. The Bible says, I, Jesus, so it was the Lord Jesus Christ talking now, have sent my angel to give you this testimony for the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright morning star. I, Jesus, what a bold statement from the Lord. I, Jesus, it was a futuristic declaration. Could you imagine if Jesus is just an ordinary guy, if Jesus is just a limited person, if Jesus is just human being, what in the world is he declaring? I, Jesus, have sent my angel to give you this testimony for the churches. So if you're going to study the book of Revelation, there are several churches that God mentioned through his angels, seven churches. And there are so many descriptions about those churches. Now, as we study the book of Revelation chapter 22, okay, bear with me. Jesus said, look, I am coming soon. Wow. Amen. Look, he is coming soon. Look where? Look how? Look, I am coming soon. My reward is with me. The one who is coming has a reward. How many of you love reward? Everything we do, we wanted to be rewarded. Because you made some effort, you know, you invested something, you did something to somebody. You are, every one of us, we are looking for a reward. We love reward. Jesus said, I am coming soon. Amen. My reward is with me. You see, Jesus is coming and he's going to give us reward. And that reward for sure is made not in China, made in heaven. Amen. Hello, are you with me? It's made in heaven. And if it is made in heaven, that is full of surprises. And that if that is made in heaven, for sure, praise God, that is great
that is awesome, that is wonderful, that is powerful. I can't wait. You need to be excited. Amen. And the Bible says, and I will give to each. It doesn't matter if there are hundreds of millions of people following the Lord Jesus Christ. The reward will always be there. God will never lack any supply. Amen. He will give a reward to each person. Tell to your neighbor, be ready. Come on, look to your neighbor. Be ready for your reward. Amen. And that is heavenly reward. And the Bible says, and I will give to each person a reward. What kind of reward? I don't know. But according to what they have done. Now this is the big question. What are you doing? How's your life? What are you doing? What did you do yesterday? What are you doing? What am I doing, Lord? Jesus said, look, I am coming quickly. I am coming very soon. When he comes, he will come with reward. And everyone, each one, will receive a reward from the Lord. Amen? So that's the reason why it's very important for us to have that attitude, waiting for the Lord. And this is one of the encouragement of Paul in 1 Corinthians verse 17. The Bible says, nevertheless, each person, again, should live as a believer. Each person, again, each person, live as a believer. What are you doing? Are you living as a true believer? As a believer in whatever situation the Lord has assigned. It doesn't matter if you have lots of problems, if you have sickness, if you are in poverty, if you are being blessed with material things and so on and so forth, whatever the situation, if you are up or you are down, there are so many things going on in your lives, if there are so many challenges in life, whatever situation. Everybody say, whatever situation. You have to believe. You have to live as a believer. You will not just believe or live as a believer if everything is fine and cool and everything is okay. No matter what, you have to live as a believer in whatever situation. Amen. Are you still a believer if you didn't have a new car? Are you still a believer if you didn't have a new house? Are you still a believer if you are still single? Are you still a believer if you are, not getting younger? Are you still a believer if there's so many pressures coming from your house, from your family, your wife, your husband, your kids? Are you still a believer? Can you still live as a believer? In whatever situation, the Bible says the Lord has assigned to them, just as God has called them. Because the most important thing is not the situation. The most important thing, God called you. Amen. Just a reminder, everything here is just temporary. This is the rule I lay down in all, where? Churches. And the church is not the building, remember? The church is what? Actually, it's not the what, it's the who. It's a group of people who accepted Christ as Lord and personal Savior. Why we need to live as a believer in whatever situation? As a church, because the Bible says, and to present her to himself as a radiant church. Glowing, amen, glowing church, or any other blemish, but holy and blameless, without stain, without a wrinkle.
Ayan. It's good. No wrinkles allowed in heaven. Oh my goodness, Pastor, are you sure? You know, every month, every quarter, you know what I'm talking about? No, that's not what he's talking about, okay? He's talking about our personal walk with the Lord. No stain, no wrinkles. If you want to stay spiritually young, you know, don't let stain or wrinkle stay in your heart. See, you look more beautiful when you let go all those problems and all those struggles in your life. We're not saying forget the problems. You know? As long as we are here on earth, we're going to have problems. What we are saying is you have to overcome. As you overcome, you have to trust God. Okay? Because one day the Lord said that He will come and He will give the reward. And the church must live as a believer in every situation. And because one day He will present the church or her to Himself. Okay, it's like there will be a spiritual wedding ceremony. Without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. So Jesus Christ said, I am coming soon quickly. I am coming very, very soon. Amen? So we need to be ready. What are we doing in our spiritual walk with God? Sometimes when there are too much pressures coming from different directions, we quit, we run away, we blame God, we blame people, we go from one place to another, we entertain hatred, unforgiveness, anger, you know, all kinds of things. You know what? That is not God's will for us. God's will for us is without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. See, in verse 13 of Revelation 22, the Bible says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. How many of you already encountered this? Alpha and Omega. Alpha and Omega is the first and last word, or in the alphabet of Hebrew. And when we talk about that, when Jesus Christ said, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end, it's all the same. In that word, Jesus refers to Himself as eternal. It was a very, very strong word when Jesus Christ said three times in the book of Revelation, I am the Alpha and the Omega. See, imagine if Jesus Christ is just human being. If Jesus Christ is just a man, just an ordinary guy, declaring this, he became a lunatic and at the same time taking himself to be making himself to be God. If he's just human being, that is blasphemy. And he deserved to die. But Jesus said, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning, the end. But there are some people, oh, if he is God, why Jesus has a beginning? Why Jesus has an end? Because God has no end, right? God has no beginning, right? Common sense. Yeah. But you need to understand, in the book of John, when some disciples are asking about
The truth of Jesus, the kingdom of God, Jesus told them, if I will tell you the things of heaven, you don't understand. That's why I'm using parables. I'm using your own language for you to understand eternal things. If I will use heavenly things, you cannot understand what I'm trying to tell you. That's why he's using all kinds of examples and parables in a way that people, they understand what Jesus Christ is trying to convey to them. Now, let's see, if this is the mindset of others, okay, Jesus has the beginning, Jesus has an end, so he's not God. God has no beginning. Are you sure? Try to look these three verses. Isaiah 41 verse 4. God himself said, I, the Lord, I'm the first and with the last, I am he. God himself, he declared, I, the Lord, if Jesus Christ is saying, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. And then in the Old Testament, before Jesus Christ became human being, God himself declared already, I am the Lord. I am the first and with the last, I am he. Was Jesus telling a lie, a lunatic, committing blasphemy, or a great imposter? But even in the Old Testament, it was already mentioned. Not only once. Isaiah 44 verse 6 says, I am the first and I am the last, and beside me there is no God. You see, if Jesus Christ is just human being, when he declared that in the book of Revelation, I am the first and the last, the beginning and the end, he is committing a great crime. And he's not worthy to follow. But Jesus is more than a human being. Jesus is more than a man. He is God who became flesh. Hello, are you with me? And not only twice, even in Isaiah 48 verse 12, I am he, I am the first, I also am the last. Why our God declared these words? Because that's how people understand. That's how people perceive the kingdom of God. That there must be the beginning and the end. God, in the very first day, God created the heavens and the earth. So Isaiah ascribed this aspect of Jesus' nature as part of the triune God. So these are clear indications of the eternal nature of the Godhead. And the Old Testament also highlights the use of first and last as marking the beginning and the end of something. There's always a beginning, then there will always be an end. And we are approaching to the end. He is coming very soon. Again, Jesus Christ said in Revelation chapter 1, behold, he is coming with clouds, and in every eye will see him. During that time, it's impossible. How in the world that every eye can see the coming of Jesus Christ? During that time, it's impossible. Now, the big question, is it impossible even today? With all the media, with all the technology? No. See, one of the prophetic messages in the last days was already fulfilled in the 60s. Even they who pierce him and all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so, amen. And one of the big words here in verse 8, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, who is, who was, and who is to come. And take note, he used the word, what? The Almighty. If Jesus is just a human being, we are all doomed. And we will never receive eternal life. But Jesus said, who he is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Jesus is the Eternal One and the Almighty who will one day return
to fulfill the remaining prophecies of Scripture. Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega in His eternal nature, His role in creation, His sustaining of the universe, and His fulfillment as the Messiah. You see, among the Jewish rabbis, it was common to use the first and the last letters of the Hebrew alphabet to denote the whole of anything from beginning to end. So Jesus, as the beginning and end of all things, is a reference to no one but the true God. This statement of eternality could apply only to God. Otherwise, Jesus was a great imposter. Otherwise, Jesus was a great deceiver. Otherwise, Jesus deserved to go to hell. But Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come unto my Father except through me." Amen. Let's give the Lord a clap of praise. Hallelujah. See, being the Alpha and the Omega is that He was at the beginning of all things and will be at the close. It is equivalent to saying He always existed and always will exist. That's why the Bible declared, "I am the same yesterday and today and forever. Through Him all things were made. Without Him nothing was made that has been made." As God incarnate, He has no beginning, nor will He have any end with respect to time, being from everlasting to everlasting. He is the God who became human flesh in order for us human flesh to be saved and to have eternal life. Amen. Christ is the first and last in so many ways. He is the author and the finisher, author, beginning, first, Alpha, and the finisher, Omega, last, end of our faith. Signifying that He begins it and carries it through completion. And that's the reason why the song that Sister Carol sang, "He who began a good work in you, He is able to finish and complete it." Amen. Let's give the Lord a clap of praise. Hallelujah. He is the fulfilling end of the law. He is the beginning subject matter of the gospel of grace. Through first and last, that all in all of our salvation, through faith, not of works, so that we should not boast. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, beginning and the end. Revelation 22 verse 14 says, "Blessed are those who wash their robes, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may go through the gates into the city." How many of you are honest enough to say, "I'm a good washer"? How many of you do laundry? Don't be shy. You see my hand? That's why every Monday, don't disturb me. I'm very busy. I'm fulfilling my job. The Bible says, "Blessed are those who wash their robes." Wash their robes? What robes? The word wash, is in the what? The present tense. All right? It is in the present tense and is referring to our daily communion, to our daily confession, for the purpose of experiencing intimate relationship, intimate walk with God, intimate fellowship with Christ. Wash. What do you mean by that? See, because, you know, God is a loving God. Every time we committed sin, every time we made something that is, you know, not good, hurting the heart of God, come to Jesus and confess your sin. God is, He is always faithful and just to forgive you and to cleanse you from all of your unrighteousness. See, it happened in the book of Revelation, chapter 7, verse 13. "Then one of the elders answered, saying to me, 'Who are these? Who are these arrayed in white robes, and where did they come from?'" So the elders were so amazed. People are coming to the very throne of God, and they're worshiping and honoring and magnifying the Lord. And then the angel of the Lord
said, and I said to him, sir, you know. He said to me, these are the ones who come out of the great tribulation and washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. The robe, one verse, is a figure for one's work. Okay? Work, wash your robes. Let's see. Revelation 19:8, and to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of what? The saints. Who are the saints? Who among us believe you are a saint? Sure, huh? The righteous acts of the saint. People who wash their robes will have access to the tree of life, access to the gates of New Jerusalem, and they will be able to enjoy intimate fellowship with God. See, the reference here is to those who qualify for the entrance into the city, the new heaven and new earth. And though obedience to the commandments of the Lord should be a characteristic of believers, and may even give a bit evidence of one's faith. So entrance into eternity is to have an access. It's good to have an access. If you didn't have access to your internet, and maybe you forgot your password, you have in big trouble. So you know, in our personal life with God, you need to have an access. Amen. So in order for you to have an access, you need to know the password. And what is the password? Do you have any idea the password to access the goodness of the Lord's blessing? It spells like this, J-E-S-U-S. And what does it mean? I can't hear you.
Jesus.
I can't hear you.
Jesus.
I can't hear you.
Jesus.
Yes. If you regularly confess, if you regularly walk, if you regularly live, you will experience rich fellowship with Christ on earth, and you will be blessed with a rich kingdom entrance. Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. You need to be sure about your life, about your salvation. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. See, if you are sure about your salvation, you will not be stumbled. Hurt, negative feelings, you know, anger. It doesn't stop you worshiping God. Amen? If you're angry with your sister or brother, if you have something in your heart against someone, against brother, sister, co-worker, whoever, and you're being stumbled all the time, I think you need to revisit your personal walk with God. There's something wrong with you. Hello, are you with me? Do you love your sister? Do you love your brother? Do you love people around you, your family? If you still letting those things inside of your heart, oh, every time I see sister, every time I see brother, every time, you know, I got stumbled and this and that, you know, that's why maybe I'm not growing. It's not my problem, it's your problem. Hello, are you with me? Why? Because the Bible says if you do these things, it's not my job. My job is to preach the word of God and share the gospel and to guide you. Now it's up to you to walk according to God's will. If you want to grow, if you want to be empowered, if you want to be used by God, if you want to do things great for God, if you do these things, you will never, 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 never stumble. Amen. Hello, are you with me? So there are so many Christians, they get still stumble. Oh, pastor, why you're getting fat? So imagine that. Oh, I don't want to go there. I don't want to preach in their church anymore. I got stumbled. You know my response? Praise God, because I am blessed. You know, that's the reason why. Hello, are you with me? I still get stumbled when people, oh, sister, why you are this? Why you are that? Why you are that? Why you are this? Doing this? Why? Come on, stop doing it and start growing up. Will you please tell to your neighbor, grow up? Come on, one more time at the back. Grow up. In your phone, grow up. Only the pastor is not growing. The Bible says it's up to us. And there are people sometimes, Pastor, why you don't have children? It hurts me, you know. But instead of responding to that, I have lots of children. And my place is in heaven, not here on earth. It's better for me to have that mindset instead of arguing with people. I am tired of arguing with people. Because it's better for me to stay in the presence of God. I want to be used by the Lord. Instead of getting stumbled every time I heard a negative word, every time I heard something that is not right and telling me this and that kind of thing, I don't want to hear those anymore. I want to hear God's thing. I want to hear the things of God. I want to hear the blessings of God. I want to see the power of God in my life because He is coming soon. If I will let the spirit of those things inside of my heart, what will happen if Jesus comes tomorrow? Not unless if you want to stay in tribulation, you can take care of this church, you know. It's good, at least. If you want, just let me know. For so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. There is an overflowing presence and grace and power and provisions and blessings of God to those who walk with the Lord, to those who stay in the presence of God. Oh, hallelujah. You will never stumble. You will never stumble. Because it's time for us to realize we are serving not human being, we're serving God. Amen? We're serving God. Take note that the multitude washed their own robes. Sounds like righteousness by works. But what cleansing agent did they apply? What cleansing agent did they apply? In their spotted robes to make them clean. The blood from the Lamb. Imagine. Praise God, not the tide, not the, what else? But the blood of the Lamb. If there are some stain or wrinkles in your robes, wash it by the blood of the Lamb. If there are so many anger, things that are not right before you, you need to wash by the blood of the Lamb. If you are living the things that are not right before God, hallelujah, let the blood of Christ wash it. Amen. And you have to wash it.
I'm good in washing. Yeah. Because just put in the machine, just wait. You know, after 30 minutes. Some feel that Jesus does it all for us. Of course, in a way, He does. Because pure righteousness is only His righteousness in us. No other name and no other blood can make us clean, but we must apply that blood. Apply the blood. So if you don't want to be stumbled, if you don't want to walk away from the presence of God, if you want to experience more of His presence, His goodness, His love, His grace, you know, God is going to use you more. Walk with Him. If you do this, the Bible says, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. Amen. The Bible says, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling." Remember, we are saved by grace. But as long as we are walking here on earth, you have something to do. That's why you need to walk in the ways of God, in the will of God, in the word of God. You have to pray. You have to keep yourself pure and don't allow negative words. People are people, people. They will always say all kinds of words they like. But don't let those things stay in your heart. Come on, somebody. Amen. That's why you need to put the breastplate of righteousness, not the breastplate of whatever. Breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation. Amen. Hallelujah. And I tell you, God, we're going to use you more in a mighty way. We must claim the promises, roll up ourselves, and do the washing. This means tough decisions, step out and act on God's claims on our lives and not on how we feel. We don't depend on what we feel. We depend on the word of God, and that is faith. And faith without works is dead. But without faith, you cannot please God. Amen. Why? Because the Bible says in Revelation 22 verse 15, outside are the dogs. Remember, dogs cannot enter into heaven. Remember that? Well, this is the answer. It's not really the dogs. What kind of dogs? These are the kind who practice magic arts, if you're still involved. Sexually immoral. See what's going on now in this country. Let's take this opportunity to bring the gospel. The murderers, the idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. These, it's very strong words. It's in the Bible. I can't change it, okay? These are the dogs. It's not really your dog, okay? That's why, whoo, thank God. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to give you this testimony for the churches, for the believers. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright morning star. And verse 17, the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears say, come. Let the one who is thirsty come. And let the one who wishes take the free gift of the water of life come. Hallelujah. How many of you are thirsty? Come. How many of you are longing for the presence of God? Come. How many of you are looking for eternal gift from God? Come. Free gift from God? Come. How many of you are hungry? How many of you are looking for the presence, the goodness, the blessings of God? Come. Come to the Lord. That's why the Bible says, those who are heavy laden, those who are burdened, those who are the different kinds of troubles in life, come unto me and I'll give you rest. Whew. I'll give you rest. Come. I warn everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this scroll. If anyone adds anything to them, God will add to that person the plagues described in this scroll. And we don't want that. That's why you need to work. We need to follow the Lord. You need to obey God. In verse 19, if anyone takes words away from this scroll of prophecy or the word of God, God will take away from that person any share in the tree of life and in the holy city which are described in this scroll. We don't want to do that. Amen. We want to be, we want to follow the Lord. We want to obey God. We want to be pure for God's presence. Amen. And 20, he who testifies to these things, yes, I am coming soon. Can you testify to other people? He's coming soon. Can you share? Jesus is coming soon. Yes, I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Maranatha. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with God's people. Amen. Hallelujah. And that's why the Bible says He is coming very soon. We need to be ready. We have a sure foundation because our Lord and Savior is the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. And we need to live as believers in the Lord in whatever situation. Don't allow the enemy to steal your destiny. Amen. Don't allow the negative words. Don't allow the works of the flesh, the works of the enemy to overwhelm you. But instead, Jesus said, look, for I am coming very soon. Praise God. Look unto Him. He is the author and the finisher of your faith. And come to Him. If you are thirsty, if you are hungry for the Lord, you're looking for more, come to the Lord. Don't allow anybody to stop you coming to the very presence of God. God wants to do more in your life. God wants to use you in a mighty way. Amen? Amen. Let's give the Lord a mighty clap of praise. Amen. Shall we all stand in the presence of God today? Hallelujah.